The difference in my experience is that I had grown up in a very small, tight-knit community where I lived very closely to my extended family. My cousins, my aunts, my grandpa was next door. I could attend ceremony, longhouse, different kinds of gatherings, anytime that I wanted to. I also grew up doing all kinds of cultural sporting activities. Now I was completely removed from that. I was also in an atmosphere where I was sitting in a classroom where I was the only Indigenous student there. When the discussions came up about Indigenous students, or in my ethics class, a 400 level nursing class that discussed some of the ethical dilemmas that came up, one of the case studies that was discussed passionately, not by me but by other students, was about a young Indigenous family that had a baby that was expected to pass away. Yet the medical system, mainstream medical system, insisted on treating this child with very, very extreme medication regime, despite the child's expectancy to die. And the family said, you know what, we don't want this child to have to go through. It was similar to chemo. I can't remember in this moment what it was. But the family said, you know, given the side effects of what this medication is going to cause, we want to live with our child in the short amount of time. You see, our child is going to live for 1 month. We want to have this peaceful time with our baby before it dies. And they said, no, you are mandated to give this medication or we will apprehend your child. Now, for anybody who knows the history of our people from contact, that it was by law that our children were removed from their families in villages and reservations forcefully by law, that they had to attend residential schools. If those children were, if the parents said no, they would just arrest the parents and say, well, we're taking your children anyways. One of the pieces of history of our people. There was a time where there was also what's called the 60 scoop, where children were apprehended because parents were deemed unfit because they didn't practice a Western lifestyle or many other reasons. And so now here is a story in my classroom with a number of students discussing the ethical dilemma of whether or not to bring the police in to apprehend this child, to treat this child who will die in a month, whether or not they're given this medication. And I'm sitting there in the classroom feeling like a mouse, thinking, you know, why would you apprehend that child? Isn't this reliving history again? And I'm sitting in the classroom feeling totally unsafe while all of these other non-Indigenous students are saying, you know, these Indigenous people are wrong. This is what should happen. They should call the police. And I'm, you know, I'm shrinking deeper and deeper into my chair thinking, do I speak up and say something? Or will I be completely unheard? And eventually I did speak up, and it was such an emotional thing to speak up in the classroom about what my viewpoint was and to rationalize what my thoughts were, because they were completely opposite of everybody else's thought in the room. And some of the people in the back of the room continued to berate me on my belief and that I was wrong. And I became emotional and I had to leave the room. So, I mean, this was not an encouraging experience for me to speak up about, not only identify myself as an Indigenous person, but also to speak up about what my view or my worldview was or belief systems around healthcare, or even to share what I had learned, what my community believes. So this was one of the negative experiences that I had had. So after we next had a cultural class, I think some of the nurse, did we have some nursing students in the room? A few of the nursing students? Is it in your fourth year, 400 level, you guys have a cultural class? I've heard great things about this class. And see, we never had this curriculum at UBC because they said, no, in our cultural class, we're sort of going to just graze over everybody. And I remember hearing some students that had called my office at Stall Nation and said, we want to interview you about First Nations health. And I was like, I just about dropped the phone. I said, really? Sure. Come to my office, I'll take you out for lunch. It was great. It's a totally different experience than what I had when I went to school. So I think different schools are coming along, but I just want you guys to give yourselves a round of applause here at UFV. You're doing great things. Progress towards discussion, acceptance, and even just learning about Indigenous health is a very progressive thing, and it's happening right now here in the school. Upon graduating, I survived what I would call survival of 4.5 years of moving away from my community, being totally submerged in a Western educational experience at UBC. Was challenging. I learned so much, not only about nursing, but I learned about myself. I learned about the resilience that lives inside of me. And I learned about what I wanted to do with that education when I moved home. I did work bedside for a year at St. Paul's Hospital. And I worked on what we called the penthouse. So it wasn't really the penthouse. It's probably the most challenging floor to work on. So it was post-op care, surgical, any kind of surgery that happened. But this was before any of the health, at that time they were called health authorities. This was before any sort of indigenization had happened. So I was one of the only Indigenous faces on the floor, and quite often there was a lot of Filipino nurses on the floor, and everybody tried to speak Tagalog to me because nobody ever guessed that I was Indigenous. And that's one of the things I noticed even in school or anywhere. Nobody ever guessed that I was Native. They always said I was Filipino or Spanish, or, you know, it was almost as if my race had died and we didn't exist. You know, kind of sort of like died during the Pocahontas era. And these stereotypes existed, and so everywhere I went, whether it was in class and then it continued into my workplace, that I felt like people were like, oh, ask Inez, she knows, she's Native. Oh my goodness. And at a certain point, I had to explain, I'm not an expert on Indigenous health. I know what I know about myself. I know about my experience, but I was more than willing to share what I had learned. I realized that there was a gap, there was a need for education, and I could provide at least what my perspective was. And I had to make that very clear anytime I spoke about Indigenous health, that this was my experience and all my perspective, my personal professional perspective. And so quite often when I did bedside care in St. Paul's, I was pulled as the Indigenous or the Aboriginal liaison. Say there was a chief on the floor who had been traveling, say, from the Nass River in northern BC, and he was down in Vancouver for the all chiefs meeting, and he was hospitalized. So I would go in and ask him, and I would ask, is there a CHR in your community that can help pay for travel, or, you know, these sorts of different things that we need to navigate within Aboriginal health that a lot of the health staff in the hospital didn't understand. Is there a service that we can provide so that connect, or any paperwork that we can provide to the band office to show that this is what's happening, some of these things can be funded, and none of the other nurses or anything knew anything about Indigenous health. Fast forward a year later, the health authorities had started to what they call indigenize. They started to hire Aboriginal nurse educators to come into different health services and start teaching about Aboriginal health, the climate of Aboriginal health, statistics on why we are overrepresented in so many different areas, such as diabetes, poor health-seeking behaviors, all of these sorts of things, providing a context to that, a historical context, and how that historical context impacts the numbers that we're seeing today. And so now fast forward to today, the different services that exist. Is everyone familiar with how Aboriginal services are delivered today? Crickets. Crickets. That's okay. So traditionally, I don't know, are you familiar with how Canada disseminates their health service funding to fund our healthcare system? Oh no, okay. The quick and dirty. The federal government has all of this money. They transfer it to the province. The province then disseminates it to the health regions. Yeah? Okay, very straightforward. So before, for Aboriginal healthcare services, specifically on reserve, it was all operated by the federal government. The federal government would then give the money to the band, and then the band would operate their health services were on reserve. BC is the first province to have a First Nations Health Authority. So we have a province-wide First Nations Health Authority. So it's federally transferred to the First Nations Health Authority in the province, and then it's disseminated to the band so that we can have culturally specific and culturally relevant healthcare. So this has just happened, say, in about a year. So that transition is very, very new, and a lot of those changes are happening now. I actually just came from a meeting with my nurse advisor at Stolen Nation Health. So speaking of which, I'm now employed as a clinical nurse lead at Stolen Nation Health Services. We provide complementary and supportive healthcare delivery services of public and community healthcare services to those that live on reserve or anybody that walks through our door. So everybody's familiar with public health. You go to public health, you can get your immunizations, you go with you there and do your intake if you're expecting a baby so that the hospital knows when you might come in labor. And then they know to come and visit you and do some health education on the phone or at home when you come home with your baby. So we do the same thing, but we do services that are culturally relevant and culturally safe so that we can make sure our clients are taken care of. And we quite often do quite a bit more support than what mainstream healthcare does. So clients, whether they're on or off reserve, can access any service, whether you're native or not. They can come to us if they're on reserve First Nations, or if they don't want to access our services, they can go to public health if they want. This is their decision. So for a long, long time, there's been a jurisdictional challenge that where mainstream services would say, well, here's the border. See, the line's right there. That's the reserve on that side. And you guys get money from the feds. And over here, this is public. This is for everybody else. And you'd imagine that this is an old argument, but everybody in this room, native or not, status, on reserve or not, we are all citizens of Canada. So we should all qualify for any service. So this has just recently, in the last few years, been clarified that if you're on reserve on the other side of that border, on reserve and status, you qualify for the same services as any other Canadian. So just to provide some perspective, that these are the things that we're still clarifying. That myself, a young Indigenous status on reserve woman, I am a Canadian citizen and qualify for the same services. Doesn't that seem a little backwards that we're just clarifying that stuff now? But it's a need. And it's amazing that I think UFV has a program like this, that we have an opportunity to share these stories. We're educating one another, discussing these things, and sometimes asking the challenging questions that sometimes we're embarrassed to ask. You know, and it's okay to not know, because now is the time to talk about it. Now is the time to come together and discuss, collaborate, and unify all the programs that exist so that we can come together and provide good services to everybody. So that's the interesting challenge that I have in my role now at Stolen Nation, looking at what the First Nations Health Authority services are and looking at how we can make them specific to meet the needs of the people in our communities. People who have geographic barriers. Perhaps they live in Lacamel, which is a community on the other side of the river that is maybe 20 minutes away from Mission. So if you don't have a car and you have a newborn baby and you have, say, mastitis. Anybody know what mastitis is? Boop, engorged breast. Can very quickly lead to sepsis. And you don't have transportation. There's a barrier, for example, that community member might be facing. So we will pack up a total mobile clinic into a van and we'll drive all the way out there and we may do a home visit or we may set up a clinic at that band office. So that's an example of what the services are that we provide here at Stolen Nation Health. So that's a bit of perspective about my experience as an Indigenous nurse. Different people have different experiences, and we're going to hear pretty soon from some of the other students here at your very own school and what their experiences are. But before we move on to that, does anybody have any questions for me and what my experience might have been or anything specific to me? Ask anything.
If you do have a question, I'll bring this microphone to you so you can ask. Hands up if you have a question.
Okay, then
line
it up.
Let's
go.
Why, So the question was, what was my choice in to change, transition from going to be a physician to a nurse? So one thing I did, I was very keen, I was always that chatty kid, and I probably still am. Whenever I saw a physician, nurse, sonographer, x-ray technician, I always asked them, tell me about your job. Where did you go to school? How long did it take? Is there a demand for your profession? Was it easy for you to get a job when you did, and is it easy to get a job now? I asked them all those sorts of things. And what I learned and what I observed from physicians is that they very quickly asked you, did the focus assessment. If anybody's done their rotation as a nurse, you know you do your full head-to-toe assessment and you do your focus assessment, and the physician just comes over and does their focus assessment and listens to a bowel sound in one quadrant, and then they're done and they make their decision. They don't really look at your charting. Thinking, what did I do that head-to-toe for? That was what I noticed even in my doctor's visits, is that it was a very quick chat. They turned their back and wrote a script. And I thought, you know what, I like sitting with people, chatting with them, getting to know them, and finding out how I can establish a rapport with them and have an ongoing relationship. And I don't see that happening if I was to work as a physician. Yes, I would have an impact as a physician, I don't deny that, but I enjoy the interpersonal relationships that I have as a nurse, and that's why I chose to be a nurse. I also had a role model who was also my aunt, who is an Aboriginal nurse, and she went back to school, received her high school diploma, then did her prerequisites, and then applied to nursing school and graduated from nursing school, and then now works in the Aboriginal community. And to me, I thought, you know, if I was in that position, I would have felt defeated and probably would have never done it. But I realized if she can do that, I can go back to school and switch faculties, not a problem. And so I was inspired by the resiliency around me and in my family, the different people who had gone to school within my family. I have an uncle who's a lawyer. My aunt is the chancellor of this university, Gwen Point. My parents are both teachers. My dad's working on his PhD. So there's a movement within my family and in the larger community. And I have community members in the crowd right now that are very well educated and, you know, are working in the community. There's a forward movement happening to that no matter what you do, contribute to the forward positive movement and collaboration for the betterment of our community. Not just the Indigenous community, but the overall community, so that we can work together in unity. So I felt that my impact would be better as a nurse. Suited my personality, I think, as well. Thank you. Anything else? Yes. Good question. Okay, I thought we were just going to focus on health. Thank you. So the question was, how do you integrate a pop music career into nursing? So the real story behind that is, when I moved away from home the second time to go to university, because I had flunked out of university the first time I went when I was going to be a doctor, remember making it rain, all that silliness? And the second time I went back, I had some goals that I was going to be self-disciplined, attend class every day, be prepared, study, and I was only allowed to go on dinner dates or go out with my friends after my midterms were done because of the demand. And all of you who are students in this room and who have graduated or gone to post-secondary know the time demand and the self-discipline that's required to be successful in school. And so part of my self-care that I had to implement immediately as soon as I left my home community was some of the things that I enjoy doing. I enjoy working out, and I really enjoy writing, because it was a cultural shock that really got me, I think, when I moved away to UBC, because I felt misunderstood, my community was very small, and I was very removed from the Stala community that I was very protected by. And so I started writing. I started writing poetry that eventually turned into songwriting. And my first album, which I published in 2009, my album was really about my experience as a young Indigenous person in today's society, and as well what that experience was going to post-secondary education institution like UBC, and as well working for Providence Healthcare at that time was called. So then I started getting requests to perform at universities, speaking about my experience and what my music meant. And that's sort of how that took off. And it got to a point where I released my second album, which is called Burn Me Down. And I ended up taking 2 years off of nursing after my second child was born. And as an addendum to that, I toured with both of my babies because our Canadian prenatal nutrition program, which is a focused targeted nutrition program on reserve, we are mandated to promote all of our ladies to breastfeed for a minimum of 1 year. So I committed to demonstrate that while I was touring as a touring pop star. So I toured everywhere with my baby and would breastfeed. And you know, we have really high, and Ryan can speak to this, Ryan's one of my coworkers from before. We have really high breastfeeding rates in our communities, and it's just sort of a norm where I'm born and raised here, and my aunties and my mom were sort of like, okay, you're breastfeeding, that's just what's happening. It's the norm. And even from Fraser Health, we'd heard that our breastfeeding rates on reserve are super duper high. And I would travel to mostly reserves and different Aboriginal communities, and I would just, you know, whip up my shirt, unclip my breastfeeding bra, and start feeding and be chatting away with whoever was hosting me, and they would be like, start twitching and get really uncomfortable. And even I had a friend in Siksika is a big reserve in Alberta, just east of Calgary, and she came and met me and drove me around, and I started breastfeeding in their band office, and she had the same reaction, started twitching, and I'm like, are you okay? She's like, nobody breastfeeds here, nobody. And even when I flew up to the coast in one of the coastal communities, I breastfed there. And I was at a school opening. It was a celebration with the entire reserve, the RCMP. And I said, I'm traveling with my son. He's over there with my auntie. And I said, I'm breastfeeding him for 1 year. Yeah. And nobody cheered except this one lady in the back who shot out of her seat. And I said, and there's the community health nurse. And she said, yeah, and she came after and was shaking my hand, and she said, you know, we have really low breastfeeding rates here. People breastfeed if they try for maybe a week. And it's a class, you're classy, or it's a financial status thing if you can afford to buy infant formula. And I thought, that's really too bad. So she said, I'm so happy you talked about breastfeeding. You made it sexy and cool. Well, I was just kind of venting that I had to breastfeed the kid right before I got on stage, but whatever works. But that's what I did, is I toured, I started writing music just as a safe way to cope with some of the challenges that I faced as a young Indigenous woman. I'm still writing when I travel to different communities and do locum nursing. Some of the things that I see, high suicide rates, some of the positive things about the resiliency, some of the positive changes that are happening, the really creative and hardworking people that work in some of our communities really inspire me to carry on. So that's where music comes in. Any other questions before we move on to the panel? No? Okay.
We have many students here who are graduating soon, some who will graduate in a year or two, and I just wonder if you could give them a piece of advice for how they can be the positive change that you're talking about.
Absolutely. So the question is, we have a lot of students here who are close to graduation, and any words of advice from me on how I can encourage you to be a positive change wherever you decide to work? So that's a really good question. So the first piece of advice that comes to mind is that sometimes you will notice a gap between theory and practice. And for those of you, I hear the low hum. You've already experienced that probably in some of your practicums or in your placements. And this is the reality. And I think sometimes keep those theories and best practices, keep a handle on them, but don't lose sight of also embracing where we at. Where are we at? Where is the state of health at? Where are our policies, procedures, and all those things at? Sometimes if we get too hung up on the theory and, you know, coming out of school, backing out of it, and not really looking at, turning around and looking where we're at in practice, there's a gap there. And we have those standards so that we can always work towards best practice. But if you hang on to those things too much, you can become disillusioned. We have to step back and take a global perspective of where we are. We live in the first world where we have excellent high standards of care. And when you look at it through an Aboriginal lens, we also have a population of people who sometimes are living in third world standards. So sometimes I find in health authorities, pardon me, the health regions, they've changed their language, we get very hung up on research and best practice and discussing at length of how we should be entering an NG tube into somebody's nostril. You know, some of those things, I think that time could be better spent looking at how we approach and, you know, looking at motivational interviewing, our communications, doing professional development on other things sometimes, because there are sometimes bigger fish to fry. But also, some of the best advice that I got when I graduated is don't lose sight of that idealism, because that's something I experienced as a student, and also what I saw some of my fellow other students that I went to school with. They felt so frustrated with the way practice looked. It's just the reality of where we're at, and actually we have a pretty high standard of how we do things in this country. So I think don't be discouraged. Hit the ground running and bring your good ideas and your great attitudes and brighten up that workplace, because sometimes there's been people who have been working there for 20 years and they're not so bright. I had my experience of being eaten alive by one grumpy nurse. She had come out of retirement after a really bad life experience. She had to drain her retirement savings. And all I felt was empathy for her, and every day she expressed how much she hated me. She would come in my face and breathe in my face and say, "I hate new graduates." "Happy to see you too today. I can't wait for this next 12 hours with you." But you know, I was optimistic that I would be persistent in being kind and gentle and communicate. And it really challenged me not to avoid this person, because I also saw this person as a massive asset to the team. Many years of experience. If I was ill lying in a bed, I would want her taking care of me. Maybe not the best bedside manner, but she was very skilled. But when you're sick, you want to make sure that person's skills are on point, right? And there was an opportunity that came up where my skill set outweighed hers in terms of being empathetic and really just comforting someone. And after that episode was over, we had to call code and all that kind of stuff. She was in the back room, and I had already announced that I was leaving the workplace. And she confessed to me that she was really going to miss me because she had learned to love me. I could hardly contain my laugh. And I said, "You know what, I've really enjoyed working with you too. I've learned a lot." But that's life. And so, you know, there's going to be a lot of people that you'll encounter, all kinds of personalities. Use patience, love, and kindness, and you'd be surprised how far that can go. All right, well, we're going to move on to our panel, and we have a panel of some excellent Indigenous students representing different faculties. And we're going to chat about a few different things, but before we get started, I'm going to have each of the panelists introduce themselves. Give them a big round of applause.
Hi, my name's Ryan Stone. I apologize if I look tired. I got married on Friday, and I had a statistics exam on Thursday. I'm super tired right now, so I apologize. My mom is status from Union Bar, which is just outside of Hope. My father's non-First Nation. I am a fifth semester nursing student. My goals after my academic career is to potentially work where I used to work at Fraser Nation with Inez Jasper, if she's still there. Plus there's a couple more opportunities, different rotations to experience, so I'm going to keep an open mind, but ideally I kind of would like to go back to Aboriginal health. And that's me.
I'm Scott Ramsey. I'm a fourth year nursing student. You can check out my healthcare presentation the morning after this lovely speech is over. My father's actually a Métis from Manitoba, the Red River Settlement. And you know where that is. My mom is non-Indigenous. And after I graduate, I moved to pediatric nursing and eventually into community health nursing.
I'm Sarah Christensen, and I graduated in 2012. I'm currently a registered nurse on maternity leave, Aboriginal hospital. And my family originally lived with but the Aboriginal side is Ojibwe from Ontario. So I had a great multicultural growing up and lots of different experiences. Hi, my name is Jessica. I'm also Métis. I'm an Acadian French Canadian from Quebec. And I'm non-status on my father's side. I plan on going into physio, but I really want to work a lot in the community. I try to find time to work in the community now, as you all know, our education is quite time consuming, so I hope to take more part in the future.
My name is Michelle. I'm a third year student in the physiology program as well. My Aboriginal background is AD, and both my parents are also from Manitoba. I'm kind of looking towards going to physiotherapy right now, but I'm not entirely sure. I want to do some volunteering. Shadow some people to get some experience and see where I'm feeling and what I love.
So just to clarify, does anybody in the room, who doesn't really understand the difference between status, non-status? How does that, what does that mean if you're Métis? If you don't know, put your hand way up. Don't be shy. Okay, a few people. We'll just clarify that a bit because a few of our panelists have explained that. So I'm status, many of the panelists are non-status. What that means is that the Government of Canada, according to the Indian Act, which is one of the only race-based laws in the world, the government has decided whether I qualify as an Indian, so then I have to register as an Indian and get a card to prove that I am, as they would say, Indian, as I would say, Native, or Stalo, what my tribe is. And so, it's a contentious issue within our community because we would recognize our own people according to where you're from, what family you're from, what tribe, or just any kind of affiliation. The challenge with status is that if you are status or treaty, as some of the more eastern provinces would identify, then you qualify for health services. As a status First Nations person, I get premium MSP as well as non-insured health benefits, which is a benefit program for status Indians. The challenge is if you're non-status, quite often many Indigenous people, Native people who are non-status have the same health disparities, but for some reason the government decides they're not going to help them with health benefits. So that's a contentious issue in itself. Just wanted to clarify for those that may not understand why that's relevant, whether you're status or non-status. So now we're going to talk to the panelists and get some information. We're interested to know from the panelists, what has your experience been as an Indigenous student here in the university? Maybe you can chat about some experiences that you've had in the classroom, positive or negative, what you learned from those things, if you've had any work experience or any just experiences that you've had as an Indigenous person that has helped you to learn or challenged you in any sorts of ways. If you guys have some stories to share with us in the crowd, that would be great. We'll start back over here at the top with Ryan.
I remember in third semester we had to do a culture presentation. So there was many cultures in the world, so there was a group of four of us. All of us were either Métis or First Nations, and one person wasn't. So we were the first ones to hand in our choice of cultures. Our first choice was First Nations because even though we are First Nations, we don't really know too much about our history for reasons within our family or whatever. There's many reasons why we didn't know our culture. So we were lucky enough to actually choose and be granted to do that that topic. Some of the students within our classroom kind of got a little bit of lateral violence against them because they felt that it was the easy way out for choosing our own culture. So we just explained to them in a nice professional way that, you know, we're learning our culture as we speak, so we're gonna try to shock and awe you. And we actually did that because there was some, when I worked at Stalo Nation with Inez, we did a 3-day course. And in it, it was the history of Indigenous peoples, colonialism, the Indian Act, 60s, everything, and then some. So I asked the person who presented that if I could use some of her notes in her presentation, and she allowed me to when I gave her reference. And at the end of our presentation, when I had showed that information, there was a couple dry eyes in the house. So I feel that it was negative at first because of everybody's mannerisms toward us, but at the very end it was a positive experience because we learned more information than we had anticipated and we were able to bring that information public. So I feel that was a positive experience overall.
I recently had the opportunity last semester, I believe it was in October, to go to the Aboriginal Nurses Association of Canada conference with one of our semester 7 faculty, Kate McCulloch, as well as a couple other nursing students from UFV. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, Kate, but I believe this is the first time that anyone from UFV nursing faculty has gone to that. You're out there? Second time? Okay, so it was my first time. And I was really shocked, I guess. There were students from all over the rest of Canada. There were students from Alberta, Saskatchewan, Manitoba, Ontario, Newfoundland. And I was really shocked to hear their stories. Being a minority and having blue eyes and white skin, obviously people don't take me as a Métis. So when I heard some of the stories that some of the people were sharing, I was shocked to hear just the environment with which they were learning. And then I got to share my story about how it's been a positive experience, and we have talked about the negative aspects, and we try to reinforce them with positive aspects. And to hear the negative stories of how they feel racism, and they can't speak up and share their story because they feel if they do, people will lash out and attack them. It made me think of how lucky I am to attend a university like this, and as Inez spoke, we are trying to put a positive spin on this. But I also did realize we do have a ways to go here. I do know there are schools in British Columbia that have seats designated to Aboriginal students, specifically talking within nursing, that have them designated so Aboriginal students can come and learn and then go back in the community. And I do think that's important that we are here talking today about this. And yes, we do put a positive spin, but realize that we do still have a ways to go, and it's something that does need to get brought to the table and talked about.
So I'll tell a little bit, not necessarily about being in school, but since I've graduated and been working, I'm also involved in the BC Nurses Union, and they do have an Aboriginal leadership circle. And I find that that's a really beneficial group where you're able to get together and work on, or talk at least, even just to vent, but to talk about issues that are happening for the community, but also in nursing and how that works within nursing and like in the hospital. And they really are focusing on different just trying to change how everyone's thinking, because there is still a lot of racism out there. And like you said, there isn't, like, when you look at me or when you look at some people, even though if you self-identify, some people don't think before they speak. And a lot of that can really, it can hurt people, and it does hurt people. So just being aware about what you're talking about, and knowing that we don't know everything, obviously. So just be open to asking more questions and be open to look at something from someone else's experience, because everyone has a different experience. So having those resources is a big help.
Just going back to your statement that there's still quite a bit of racism that exists, probably one of the most awkward things that often happens to me is you'll be having a discussion with somebody, and then they'll make a comment about the Indigenous people. The first reaction is, okay, do I tell them I'm Métis and this is going to get very awkward very quickly? Or should I just not say anything and try to avoid the conversation? Because I'm a husband, most people will not assume that I'm Métis. So if you make that conversation very awkward, normally I'll be like, well, I'm actually Métis, so this conversation makes me a little bit uncomfortable. And then it'll either go two ways, they'll either continue with what they were saying, or they'll just stop talking completely. And you don't really know how to respond to something like that. You realize that there is still a lot of racism present. And should you try to educate them on what they're saying? What should you do? And that's just something that I think we should be aware of when you speak. Before you speak, you should think that this person could receive that as hateful.
This is going to sound a little bit repetitive now at the end of the line, but that's kind of the same thing that I was going to start off saying, is that people don't necessarily think that you have that background just looking at you, but it's kind of the same as any other culture, that you just like to know your background, and you have Irish as well, that's kind of totally different, but just knowing about where you came from and your family is something that's a big part of your life, and it's nice to know. I find particularly being at UFV and in Aboriginal things such as this, that there's a big emphasis on community, and I really feel that at UFV, that there is a lot of community and it makes you feel welcome, and there's a lot of opportunities here for learning. This is one of them, and I recently just met with Lauren Andrews a little while ago, and she was helping me with some scholarships. I just feel that there's a lot of opportunities here provided for me to learn about my culture and become more in touch with it, and just have that chance to learn about my background, so it's really inviting.
Thank you for sharing that. I also have one little story to add. And it's funny because I've encountered tons of these experiences where people don't think I'm Native, but they'll speak negatively about Native people in front of me, assuming that I'm from a different culture. And I have to agree that it is very uncomfortable. And you are put in a dilemma of speaking up and making that person feel grossly uncomfortable because they have a big foot and mouth moment. Or they withdraw completely. And they don't interact with you at all. And I've had that experience in my nursing class where someone just doesn't even, like, they avoid eye contact with you for the rest of the, for the rest of your undergraduate. Awkward. But none of us can deny that we've been socialized a certain way, either by our family, who we were raised with, the schools that we were educated in, preschools, elementary schools, high schools, and it only has been recently that the curriculum has changed to include First Nations curriculum that's actually accurate, because I know that when I went to school, we learned about the Haida and then we colored totem poles. Well, that's not relevant to this area. And it wasn't entirely accurate now that I know more about Haida culture. And so there are positive changes happening, but we do have to take the opportunity to look at what are our belief systems and why are our belief systems that way? Is that because our parents have passed that on to us, or our grandparents, or whoever was around us? Even for myself, I have to think about those sorts of things. And our parents and grandparents lived in a different age. And so it's really on us to really be reflective about what our belief systems are, challenging them, and then taking in new and accurate information so that we can move forward. And when I worked in bedside care in hospital in St. Paul's, I had an experience with, she wasn't a nurse, she was actually a stalker. She stalked all of the supplies on the floor. And she was very kind, always made sure to say hello to me, and always had a compliment for me about my hair or something. And one day she pulled me into the back room. She said, "You know, I need to speak to you. I heard that you're Native. And I just want to tell you that I just think you are the most beautiful Native girl I have ever seen, because your race is naturally not very good looking at all. So good for you." Naturally, I had to take a deep breath and count backwards from 10. Because, you know, I've encountered these kinds of comments and whatnot throughout my life, but I just thought, you know, for some reason in my mind, I thought when I graduated from nursing school, I was going to graduate into this whole different area of life where I didn't have to encounter this kind of ignorance. But then I realized this is the real world and it's all around us. And like they teach you in nursing school and other health professions, this is a teachable moment. And so I said, "Thank you so much. I appreciate your comment. Unfortunately, I'm deeply offended." Ryan's heard this before. Heard me say that I'm deeply offended many times. And so naturally she responded saying that she's deeply offended that I was offended by her rejecting her comment. And the conversation started going in circles. And I said, "You know what? I'm hearing that we need to agree to disagree, because she wasn't willing to hear the conversation. She wasn't ready. She was from an older generation. She thought that I should be happy that I heard I was pretty and that I should accept being pretty over smart and all kinds of... The conversation just went quickly downhill. And so I thought, you know what? Here's my opportunity to learn and hear those words that I need to pick my battles. And that's the next topic I wanted to bring up with the panelists. Have you ever been presented with a situation where you had to pick a battle? And go.
I'm going to pass for a second. I got to think about
that. Think about that. Okay.
We learn about Aboriginal health in the nursing program. We specifically have a day for it. And one of the things that comes up, that it seems to be a constant thing, is the inequities. And we only seem to learn about those. And I think for myself, not being and growing up on reserve, I didn't really know about those. So when that comes out and people are making comments, sometimes I know you spoke to it, sometimes you do feel like it's a teachable moment, or sometimes you feel like, oh, you know, am I going to call this person out? Are we going to have a confrontation in class? And those who know me know I'm not afraid to have a confrontation in class with certain topics. But I do think it's important because a lot of it has to do with confidence, and sometimes you feel like you're not ready to speak to that. And I feel that on certain things that I'm not with that, so I think it's important to realize, like, because we don't know everything about Aboriginal health, but things we do know, we are passionate about. And I will say, it came up a couple weeks ago, and sometimes it comes up, Aboriginal is the easy scapegoat, that they're the health inequity. What about the people who, you know, have all those other factors as well? But it's always Aboriginal as the first person to come up. So I think it's just important to realize that that shouldn't always be the scapegoat, to critically think about what you're going to say before you go and say it, because that's not always the case.
I would say this was probably a long-term battle. I remember when I was 7 years old, my mom took me to school, and she was a newly single parent, and somebody made a comment that, oh, it's because they're Native. And I remember my mom was deeply upset, and she ended up with confrontation. And thinking about it, I would have not gone through confrontation. I think every day I pick my battle by trying to better my life and become a person who would never say that to somebody. And for me, that is choosing a battle. It's making your life for positive, for better, for change, for being involved, and not having those stereotypes and that discrimination for any race or culture.
I don't have a particular example about choosing a battle, but I know that there are situations like that where a lot of people make a statement based on not really having the education behind where it comes from, or even the background to make a comment like that. And I think just everyone being here and taking the opportunity again to be a part of this, or in that conversation, just being open to not having a predisposed judgment and listening, because I might not have the answer either if someone makes a comment to me, but I would just rather put it out there that I don't know and that I'd be willing to learn. Just take stuff into account before you make an assumption about someone's culture or about where they come from. Just being open and not judging.
So one battle I think that we do repeatedly see that I will step up for is in nursing. We do have a lot of patients, and patients as in people, but we will see a lot of people come back in with the same issues, and a lot of diabetic complications and different things about surrounding health. And there is that stereotype, and kind of going back towards that, people just jump to that. And with the racism, even if they're not thinking what they're saying is hurtful to that person, or just thinking like, oh, well, they have access to more health care, why don't they just take it? And that is very racist. And instead, seeing what those barriers are for that person, like So making sure people are aware and so that they know what they can access and what, like every patient has different barriers. And if you know from their personal experience, then you can see why they're coming back into the hospital. So it's not just from the culture, but it's from each person individually. So just taking the battle of education and to support your patients and advocate for them.
This isn't school related, but when I used to work at Salvation, just because of this color of my skin, color of my hair, and color of my eyes, I was seen as like an outsider. So there would be, I don't really know how to make English the traditional language for this area. So occasionally I would hear words I didn't understand, and later find out from staff that they're calling me like half breed, half native, half not native. So when referencing choosing my battles, as a community health worker, I would go and offer to provide whatever assistance I could, or whatever information I could back to the team to see how we could help them. Because of my skin, hair, and eyes, they wouldn't listen to me. They wouldn't really trust me. So in order to build a rapport, I would have to wait for them to be ready to come seek my help. And then, because it's weird not providing services and someone going no and not knowing why, then later realizing because you don't look at the stereotypical First Nations person, that they don't trust you. And goes back to colonial times with the trust issues with the government and First Nations people. So I chose to pick my battle that to help people when they were ready, rather than forcing myself to help them. So, but then as soon as they were ready, I had so many relationships when I left Scholar to come to school. I swear I made a lot of people cry because they wouldn't have the same person that they could come and seek assistance from. So I think that really worked to my benefit, just waiting for them to be ready.
Thank you. So confrontation is a challenging issue that First Nations students and people who work as providers in First Nations communities encounter on both sides of the coin. So like some of the students had said, feeling confrontation in class from students, even professors and teachers and faculty members. I'd had an experience where I had a confrontation with a faculty member who challenged me on a conversation we were having, where I was advocating to have Aboriginal seats set aside to meet a huge gap that we're now experiencing even worse because of the First Nations Health Authority that is in place. So to help meet those health inequities and gaps that exist, we need more capacity of people who have the capacity to meet those needs. So there is a huge need for Aboriginal seats in all schools across Canada. Most nursing schools in BC have seats set aside, a very small amount of seats, and those people who apply for those seats still need to meet the same academic standards as everybody else. Just to clarify. Just to comment on what Ryan was saying, I think that was an important point that you brought up about the way that we look. I think it's a natural human response to judge other people on the way they look, but we need to be conscious of that judgment. So like I had said earlier, quite often people would judge me as not being Aboriginal. They would judge me to be Asian, Spanish, Mexican, you know, fill in the blank, everything else but Native. And so I had worked with Ryan as a co-worker, and I had seen that firsthand by the Aboriginal community, the First Nations Dal community that he served, that he was being judged as in our language, Cholitum means non-native or Caucasian. And so quite often we had to reiterate to people that Ryan is a descendant of Union Bar, this is his mom, yada, yada, yada. And it took time for him to build a rapport. And I think that applies to everybody as a health practitioner. Building a rapport with your client base, patient, or anybody that you're serving is the key to connecting with anything that you're trying to do, any kind of service. And for some people, it's going to, based on their history, experience, and in the Aboriginal community, quite often a negative experience with authority and oppression. Trust is a very challenging thing to establish with our history of forcible removal of children to residential schools, 60 scoop. Can you imagine a community without children? Those parents feeling completely disempowered. Things like laws, are people not allowed to hire lawyers to advocate for our laws? some of the stories that my father has told me about the DIA dentist, which is a Department of Indian Affairs, who would hire dentists who were being questioned by their licensing authorities. So they would get sort of shuffled to work for Indian Affairs, and they would travel to the Indian reserves. And my dad would have, remembers having his teeth pulled, all of them pulled, because a dentist was paid. And I mean, dentistry was kind of archaic for everybody at that time. But he remembers, you know, the dentist was always intoxicated, and there was subpar care because it was for the Indians. My grandmother was involuntarily sterilized because the doctor thought she was having too many babies. I didn't want to repopulate the nation with too many Indian babies. That was the thought at that time. So there's a genuine mistrust of health providers, especially if you are non-Aboriginal or you look like you're non-Aboriginal. So thank you for bringing that up. As Indigenous people, we come in all different colors and shapes and sizes, and we all have different and unique stories. So as a result of that really unique set of life experiences that we bring, I'd be really curious to know about the panel, what you went into school, what your plans and dreams were to practice, and maybe how those plans and dreams have changed now that you're partway through, or in your case, finished school. Who would care to start? Yeah, oh, she said she's gonna start at this and go back.
I originally planned to go into physiotherapy, which is still my most likely goal that I would be aiming. But my mom also works in the healthcare industry for indigenous, working for Fraser Valley and UFV Nursing Health Fair. She actually goes on reserves with different Native groups. And lately, just, I don't know, it's come up a lot more for me learning about my culture. Applying for scholarships and stuff, I've had to write some essays about what I plan to do, what communities I want to work in, and I know my background and my family life, so it's just a really good question, actually, that I have really. So, being on this way and being where we are, having all the Aboriginal communities around us, it's really nice because a lot of the opportunities provided by school are local, so I'm really hoping to become more involved. Oh, this way, and COVID also, I'm not living up here, but being at school gives me a chance to see what's out here, hear from other people, hear from online, the opportunities and places that need help and need education and need support. So that's kind of my junior outlook for where I want to volunteer and how I want to start to learn to see where and who I'd like to work with. Because I know the kind of job that I like, but I'm not really sure what people want.
Originally, I wanted to be a restaurant manager, which is completely opposite of what I was talking about. And then I got into a car accident and I realized physical health is the ability to change lives. So that's kind of why I got into kinesiology. And then throughout my program, like Michelle here, I applied to use cannabis physiotherapy, so I had the opportunity to create a program.
Started, actually didn't go to school to begin with to be a nurse. I actually went to UBC for a year and thought I wanted to be a doctor. And I had a family member pass away while I was in the hospital. I quickly realized what happens in the hospital and who looks after the patients, spends all the time with the patients, gets rapport with the patients, talks with the family. And I quickly realized that nursing was for me, so then I decided that I transferred back out here because I'm originally from Abbotsford and moved home and went to nursing and helped back then. But I did.
As I said, I worked here for about 2.5-3 years. I worked with some pretty awful nurses that I didn't really want to go into because I used to be a carry in assisted living work before. But working with them actually kind of mentored me and said, you can do it. And I'm in it now. The worst part is over, so it's going to get better than anesthesiology and pathophysiology is done. So I'm thinking I would like to go back to community health nursing, but everyone suggests get a bunch of years of medical surgical experience. So that's I do want to go back to the First Nations.
So, well, I thought for me, stats was the rough point. Stats and medical terminology, I had a little bit of a rough patch with. Let's give a big round of applause for the panelists and sharing their personal experiences. Thank you so much. Hope to hear from some of you in the crowd in the future. Good luck with everything in school, your classes, and hope to see you in the field.
So, on behalf of the Faculty of Health Sciences, staff and students, we have a little gift for you. Nothing major, but we just want to thank you for coming in, giving us your time in, and speaking about this community also important topic. Appreciate your time.
Okay, thank you, panelists, and Inez. Great afternoon, great topic, and something we own to before, obviously. So thanks to the audience, good crowd, and one more last big round of applause.